गुड मॉर्निंग माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, आई एम राजगोपाल, फैकल्टी एंड लॉ प्रैक्टिशनर, टीचिंग यू द साइबर लॉ। लेट अस कंटिन्यू विद द टॉपिक दैट वी हैव कवर्ड इन द लास्ट क्लास। बिफोर दैट लेट अस क्विकली गो थ्रू वन स्लाइड वेर वी कैन डिस्कस व्हाट वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन द लास्ट क्लास। ओके, इन दैट लास्ट क्लास, इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड about the need of the cyber law, cyber crimes, introduction of cyber law, IT Act 2000, and world laws that are there with reference to the cyber law, on what basis the other parts of our world will frame the laws for any of the subject, and the importance of the cyber law in this present era. Okay, today my dear friends, let us directly go into the syllabus part. We will discuss into the important provisions that are there in the IT Act 2000, and what is the digital signature, what do you mean by an electronic governance, and use of electronic records, and the retention of electronic records, public rules and regulations, and who is having the power to make the rules. Okay. In the first part, that is the important provisions, we will discuss about there are 94 sections are there. At some point of time, all the sections are very much important, and few sections have been added in the Amendment Act 2008. Let us take up some important aspects, important sections for the technical students. For the technical students, digital signature, you have already studied how to generate a digital signature, what is public key, what is private key, how to generate a public key, how to generate a private key, what is hash function, all these things you have discussed in the previous classes, and the electronic governance. Here, for each and every topic, we will take it as a section wise, which section will deals with that, which section will give the power to do the electronic governance, which section will legally accept the electronic governance, and the next is use of electronic records. What do you mean by an electronic record? Who can generate this electronic record? When the electronic records will take the legal form, and when the electronic record is considered legally, and the retention of electronic records, in which form we have to retain the electronic records which have been uploaded into the computer, and the publication rules and regulations. Okay. If you are publishing certain things, what are the rules and regulations, and who is having the power to make the rules with respect to, and which section will deal with who is eligible, who is authorized to make the rules in the ITI, information technology, related to information technology. Okay, and with that we will go to the definitions, some important provisions. Let us go to the important provisions. In that, first one is section. I have divided according to the section. Section 3 of IT Act. Here, whatever we discuss is with respect to the Information Technology Act only. It is defined in the Information Technology Act 2000. Okay. Section 3, authentication of electronic records, and Section 3A will deal with the electronic signatures. Okay. So any record, whenever it goes for the evidence, whenever it is taken as an evidence, it has to be properly signed, issued by a proper authority, then only it be considered as an evidence in any of the particular case. to proceed with any of the particular case. So here, authentication of electronic records. Who is authorized? What do you mean by an authentication? Who is authorized to authenticate the electronic records? Here a simple thing is, whoever is the sender, whoever is the sender will be a person who can authorize this electronic records. Okay, whoever is the sender and whoever is the receiver of that particular records, then he will be authorized. Take an example of email. You will send a letter through email, then you are an authorized person for that particular record, whatever you have sent, whatever you have written, you are an authorized person. You have given some, you may be given some promises or whatever, maybe you may be given some declarations through email, then you are an authorized person for that electronic record. So here the law speaks about the level of security that is provided with reference to the electronic records. Okay, I think you may be knowing there are different levels of security depending on the importance of that particular record, the level of the security will increase. Okay, first level of security, let us take the first level of security which is there, is first one, I agree to the condition, a click on a button where there is an I agree to a particular condition, it is there. So few documents, for example, you are downloading a software, then you are downloading an app. In the last, while installing that, it will give one button where I agree to the following terms and conditions, whatever it is specified, that will be there. If you click on that, you will be authorized and the information will be downloaded into the system. That is known as a first level of electronic signature or security that can be provided. And the second level of signature, electronic signature or security that is provided is the passwords. Okay, there may be some password. For example, you will buy an antivirus software, you will install that, it may be online or it may be through a CD, whatever may be. When you install it, it asks some security key so that you will be authorized that you have paid the amount through online or through any means, then you will be authorized to download, to have that antivirus software into the system. It will ask some passwords or key numbers, whatever may be. Then if you enter that, then you will be an authorized person to have that antivirus software into your system. Then you can download that particular software. So that is a second level of security. Or if you are using some credit cards, there it will be asked to enter the password. Okay, you have to enter your secret password, secret key you have to enter, then you will be an authorized person to go further in that particular transaction. Okay, that is the second level of security, or e-signature, whatever you can call. The third level of security is with some biometric information. Either it may be a face recognition, iris recognition, or it may be a thumb impression, which you have to give an authentication. That is the third level of security that will be given. Okay, third level of security that can be given. That is, it will recognize you are the person who is authorized, who is sitting in front of the system, who is legally entitled to use that particular area, particular software. You can enter that particular area or whatever may be. That is the third level of security that is provided. And the fourth level of security or e-signature that can be provided is the digital keying process. Okay, that is known as public key infrastructure. That is a digital signature certificates. Okay, that is known as a public keying infrastructure, where it will be specially designed by system where you will be authorized through some steps to send or to receive some of the documents to set or to eligible, you will be made eligible to download a particular document. Okay, that is known as electronic signature. See, here what I want trying to explain is, who is authorized and what do you mean by an electronic signature? Here the main concept that the IT Act will look into it, the security, which level of security that can be provided depending on the importance of that particular record or whatever may be importance of the data that we are transmitting through the internet, so that unauthorized person should not use that particular record to do some illegal activities. That is the main intention in this particular section. Okay, and then the fourth section, section 4, is legal recognition of electronic records. Okay, an electronic record means, the simple definition of electronic record is any record which is transmitted through the telecommunication system or through the computer or through the electronic media. That is known as a electronic record. Either it can be captured from the electronic devices, it can be a CCTV cam footages, or it may be a biometric thumb impression, or it can be a data which is transmitted through the email, or it can be some forms, electronic forms that is filled. Okay, all these will come under electronic records. And then the legal recognition of electronic signature. Here, any of the signature has to be recognized legally. You have been authorized to sign. Okay, you will be given an authorization to sign that particular record. Okay, for that there should be a legal recognition. This provision, this section will give the legal recognition to the electronic records. And then sixth one is use of electronic records and electronic signature in government and its agencies. Okay, government and its agencies can also use. A law will be given, an opportunity will be given through this particular act for the government to use the electronic signature in its particular transactions. Okay, and 6A of this particular section will discuss about delivery of services by the service provider. Okay, delivery of the services by the service provider. Okay, the next important provisions are 7, retention of section 7, retention of electronic records. It is very much important. Whenever the electronic record is created, it has to be retained in its manner. Okay, it should not be changed in its format or in its field or anything. It has to be retained in the same manner. Up to what time it has to be retained, all this will be given. 7A, audit documents etc. maintained in electronic form. And 8 is publication of rules, regulation in electronic gazettes. And section 6, 7 and 8, okay, will not confer the right to insist the document should be accepted in electronic form. Okay, we can't tell that we will not accept the records which is there in the electronic form. One best example is, previously in the last session also I have taken this example. Previously the Vishweshwaraya Technological University used to publish the results with the hard copy. They used to send the result sheets into the colleges, okay, through post. Then the colleges used to open that and they used to display it on the notice board. For further actions, if you want to apply for evaluation or whatever may be, that will be considered as the date of announcement of results. So now it has changed. The university will publish the result in electronic form in its website. Everybody will go to its website and access the results, and a time will be given. That is the date of announcement of result. That will be considered as the date of announcement of result. You cannot tell that I will not accept that announcement of result through the website, through the internet. That is removed from the law. You can't tell that. That is the date of announcement of the result. After some time, after 6 months, after 1 month or 2 months, a hard copy will also be sent. Sometimes they will make you to download. The colleges can download and keep it for the records. Okay, whatever it can be done. But the date of announcement of the result is when it has been displayed, when it has been given on the website of university. That will be considered as the date of result, declaration of the result. Okay, that is there in the section 9. And section 10, power to make the rules by central government in respect of electronic signature. What should be the electronic signature? How it has to be designed? What are all the security measures that has to be given? Who is the authorized to issue the digital signatures? Okay, all these things, the power is there with the central government to make any rules. And section 10A, validity of contracts formed through the electronic means. If any contract means agreement between the two parties, two institutions, if it is done electronically, any type of consent sent through the email will be considered for any agreement. Okay, accepted through the internet, through the emails. Okay, that will be considered as a valid contract, and that will be given a legal authentication. Okay, with that only we can proceed. If somebody goes against to that, or after sending an email, if he turns back that I have not written anything, I have not given any writing, or somebody has sent, that is not acceptable. Okay. Any electronic means, a contract formed through the electronic means is valid, and that is acceptable through the law. So, the important provisions. Okay. The next, in this provisions, before going to other things in detail, we should know what you mean by an electronic signature. Mainly in this class we will discuss about the electronic signature. What do you mean by an electronic signature? I think you have come across this electronic signature in the last previous classes. The technical meaning is, a digital signature is a mathematical scheme that is used to authenticate the sender. It is a mathematical model, we can tell. There is an algorithm working behind that to authenticate a person. Who can send that particular information? Who can issue that particular electronic record? Okay, it will be authorized. I have told in the last session, last slide, I have explained the different types of security which can be provided. Here also the same thing. Okay, the last level of security is digital signature, where it is considered as a mathematical scheme or a mathematical modeling, where a signature will be generated and a person will be authorized to use that particular signature. And one more thing is, a digital signature is nothing but an attachment to any piece of electronic information which responds to the content of the document and identify the owner of the document. It is a piece of record. Any document, if you are transmitting, means a digital signature will be attached to that. Okay, a digital signature will be attached to that, telling that he is the only person who has transmitted that message, who has sent that message, and he will make that person responsible, and it will give the ownership for that particular document. That is known as a digital signature. Okay, the next, why it is required? We have discussed the definition and why it is required according to the law. We have discussed the sections that is there in the for the digital signature. That is for section 3.3a will tell you about the digital signatures and why it is required to provide an authenticity, integrity and non-reputation to the electronic document. Okay, somebody should not tell, after sending some information, somebody should not tell that I have not sent that particular document. Okay, it has to give the authentication and integrity to that particular document. Somebody should take the responsibility of sending that particular document. Somebody should take the ownership for that particular document. So that is electronic documents. That's why we need an e-signature. And to use the internet as the safe and secure medium for e-commerce, okay, for banking transactions or other type, any other type of transactions, there should be a safe and secure medium, end-to-end communication should be protected. Okay, if we are sending an information to a particular person, if we are sending some material to a particular person, we should see that it has to be reached, it has to be handed over to a particular person only. So that is why we need this particular digital signatures. Requirement of the digital signature is, you know this particular concept, that is the private key and the public key. What do you mean by a private key? You know that private key means the key which is there with the sender, who is authorized to send that particular data. And the public key is one who is eligible to receive that particular record, e-record. That is known as a public key. For example, you want to download the income tax returns that you have filed, okay, or some PAN card you want to download electronically, you want to download, or otherwise you want to download your Aadhaar card. Okay, so once after filling a particular form, once after going through the procedure that is meant for downloading the Aadhaar card or PAN card or whatever may be, if you are successful in filling that particular form, if you fill all the details properly, then you will become eligible to receive that information. That information will be transmitted to an authorized mobile number, to an authorized email ID that will be sent. One more thing will be there, that is an authorized person from the income tax department or from other authority will transmit that document with his private key. Okay, he will transmit, and you should have your key to open that. Even though it has received, this document has been received to your email ID only, to the email ID whatever you have given to the authorities. At the time, if you want to view that, if you want to take the printout of that, then it will ask some details. Okay, you have to enter the coded thing. The instruction will be given. It will be a combination of last four digit of your PAN number and first four digit of your birth date of birth. That you have to mix, or otherwise it can be first few letters of your name. Okay, first few digits of the PAN card and the first few digits of your birth date of birth. Okay, that will be given. If you know all the three details, if you enter that coded key, then only the information or the then only the document will open. It will come display on the screen. Either you can take the printout or whatever may be. Whenever you want to open that particular document, even though if you download or if you store, whenever you want to open that document, you have to use that particular key, and then only it will open. That is the best example, I think, my friends, at this point of time. Okay. This is known as the private key and the public key. How to generate, you know, you are a technical student, you are well aware of how to generate this private key and how to generate the public key. What is the mathematical modeling that is there behind this private key and public key? What are all the security issues that is taken in generating this private key and public key? All the technical details, you know. Here mainly we are discussing about the legal aspects. So with this security, with this much of security, the law will authenticate that this is a proper document that is legally acceptable. This is a proper document that is legally acceptable. Okay, that is the requirement. Next, in the last slide, we have discussed about the private key, public key and all these things. Now is the e-governance. What do you mean by an e-governance? That is an electronic governance. The IT Act 2000 will give the provisions for this e-governance, will authenticate the e-governance. In the chapter 3 of IT Act, Bare Act of Information Technology 2000, there is a provision, okay, for the electronic governance. So there are different sections which we will come across to support this e-governance. So basically the e-governance is between the four entities, four steps, that is government to citizens. It can be a transaction between the government and the citizen. Okay, it can be a government to the employees. Okay, that is also e-governance. And government to the government transactions and government to the business transactions is known as an e-governance. So, coming to this, government to the citizens. The government to the citizens means the government will give some facilities to the citizens. Citizen can access the government facilities that are there, government projects that are there. Okay, how it is functioning, who are all eligible, that will become a government to government to citizen, government to the employees, government to its employees. What are all the benefits? Any circulars to the employees? Okay, what are all the facilities that is given to the employees? That is between the government to the employees and government to the government. Either it may be state and central government, within the government departments, circulars or transactions. Okay, that will be between the government and to government, and government to business sectors. What are all the provisions? What are all the change in the government policies towards the business? Okay, what is the budget allocations for different sectors? Okay, all these will be the government to business. All these transactions will come under the e-governance, which will be considered as an authentic and valid according to the law. Government to citizen transaction, government to its employees transaction, government to government transaction, and government to business transactions. All these are authentic, made authentic, and this will be given a legal authentication to proceed in this particular matter. One best example, my dear friends, government to citizens. Any auctions, for example, nowadays if I take in the last few weeks, I have seen the government is actioning the BDA sites since for the collection of resources. Okay, for the collection of resources, it is actioning the BDA sites. Okay, so before it used to come in the paper, what is the date of action, who are all eligible for this action, how to apply for it, what are all the amount that we have to deposit, what is the form. So now everything will be in the government website. If you go to a particular website, all these details will come. When you have to apply, who is eligible for this particular action, okay, what is the minimum fee that you have to pay. Everything will become transparent, my dear friends. Everything will become transparent. There will not be any hide and seek. If you go to that website, everything will be displayed, and you should not tell that I am not knowing this particular thing. You can't go to the court that I am unaware of this particular transaction which is done by the government, actions taken by the government. Everything will be online, and you can fill the application online, you can pay online, you can submit the document online, and the auction will be done online, and the particular sites or whatever may be will be allotted online. Okay, everything will be legally acceptable. So that is a simple example of government to citizen transactions. Similarly, the government to employees transaction, government to government, and government to business. Anything which will be given in the website. One best example is National Portal of India, where the Indian central government will give what are all the activities which is happening in the different departments, how the government is functioning, what is the budget, everything, what are the actions, how it is functioning, everything will be given in the national portal of India. Anybody can access, nobody will be restricted. You can go through that. Okay, you can ask questions if you have any doubt. Okay, that is the government to citizen transactions. That is the best example, I think so, for the government to citizen transaction. Okay, here in the e-governance, in the last slide we have discussed about basic models which are available, and here the target groups that are there in the e-governance is government, as we have discussed. Governments, citizens, and business are the interest groups. Okay, here the e-governance means an electronic governance. Governance, it is a paperless governance, we can call. Okay, so where the government is involved, citizens are involved, and business and interest groups will be involved in this particular e-governance. Okay, so anybody can access that with respect to the e-governance. Okay, the objectives of e-governance is to build an informed society. In the previous governance system, there was a lack for that. Whenever it used to come in a papers, circulars, there may be some delay. Whenever it comes in the newspaper, there may be some concentration diversions may be there. Okay, the newspaper may not reach certain areas. Okay, these are all some issues. Okay, which is that in the which was there in the previous governance systems. Now if it is an e-governance, means everybody will be well informed. Okay, you should have an internet facility. If you are an interest group in that particular area, you can access that particular site and you will get all the informations which is required. For example, if you want to have a medical facility, what are all the medical facilities which are provided through the government? What is the medical insurances given? Okay, medical insurance facilities given by the government. Okay, everything will be given online. If you are interested in that particular area, you have to go to that website and all these information will be given there, to build an informed society. If somebody again going against to, that means you can question them why you are doing that. It is there in your website. You have assured in the website, but you are not following that. That is there. That is the legal authenticity. What I can tell. Okay. And then to increase the government and citizen interactions. Okay. You can participate in all the actions that is taken by the government. You can participate. You can comment on that. You can question. Okay, all this will be transparent. What is the project which is going on? What is the amount that is invested on that particular project? Who is the contractor of that particular project? How the work progress is going? Everything you can see through that particular e-governance system, and to bring the transparency. Okay, once everything will become will be displayed, and if anybody can access, means that will be a transparent system. That will become a transparent system. For example, any road construction, each and every project, when the project has been approved, when the project has been handed over to a particular person for the construction, when he has to complete, what are all the materials that he has to use? Okay, what is the cost involved in that? Okay, all these things has to be displayed. Okay, what is his contact number? Is there any queries? Whom to access? Whom to ask? All these things will be given, and you can go through that. And if you have any doubt, you can directly interact with that particular agency or particular body which is involved in that. Okay, and the next point is to make the government accountable. The government will be accountable for each and everything. You can question it through a proper place. You can question the government. If there is a road construction work, why it is not happening within that time? What is the lacuna? Who is troubling that particular road construction? Okay, why that has been stopped? Up to what time it will be stopped? At what time it will be going to complete? All these things will be questionable. So you are accountable. The money involved, everything is there, and that will become an accountable system. And to reduce the cost of governance, we can call it this as an overdue, my dear friends. Before, the cost of governance was more compared to nowadays, because everything, the time is the main thing. Okay, whenever it was signed by a proper authority, means to reach a particular person, it used to take time. Okay, and all these things used to happen. For this, everything is cost involved. Cost is involved for each and everything, due to transportation, everything, all cost will be involved. So here the e-governance will reduce the cost of the governance. Okay, because everything will be displayed online. Okay, and within that particular time the work will start, within that particular time the work will end. So the cost, definitely it will come down if it is done in a particular time. Okay, if it is done in a particular time, that is the objectives of e-governance. Everything is positive objectives. So the advantage of e-governance, that also we have discussed. Speed of execution will be more, because there will not be any overdues in sending or receiving the information. There will not be any lacuna, holding up of letters in certain places. It will not be there, because e-records will move very fast. It will go to an authorized person. The person cannot claim that he has not gone through the record. Okay, everything is accountable, and cost is reduced. Transparency and accountability, as we have discussed in the last slide. Okay, the use of records. Okay, where we will use this e-records? in filling of any applications. For example, the best example is income tax department. You need to file a income tax returns. Or each and every employees, each and every businessman who is having the PAN card need to fill the income tax returns at the end of the financial year. To the end of the financial year, what is his income? How much tax he has paid to the government? If he has paid extra, it will be refunded. Everything through the filing of income tax returns. Okay, it will be called a income tax return. Okay, there is an application form. Previously, we used to submit using the hard copies. A form was available. We used to fill up the form and we used to submit to a particular authority in a particular place. There was a queue because of the last dates or something like that. The people used to sit in the queues and the department used to arrange different desks for receiving that applications. They used to take that manually. They used to verify that manually. It used to take so much time. Now the filling of any application is using e-records. You can fill online, the form will come online, you can submit online, the receipt will come online. Okay, and the money, if you have paid extra to the income tax department, that will be refunded to your bank account directly without any hindrance. Okay, that is the advantage of e-records, my dear friends. Okay, filing of e-records, the issue or grant of any license, we have discussed that. Any license to be issued, if you have taken some license to do some work, okay, that will be sent to as an e-record. Okay, it will be sent from an authorized person, received by an authorized person. Okay, and the receipt of payment of money to the appropriate government, that is through the electronic transactions, and format of the e-records and manner and method of payment will also be there in the e-records. Then retention of e-records, that is the major question that is there. Okay, any records, for example, income tax filing, returns filing, that record has to be kept safely in the same format which we have submitted, in which we have submitted, that has to be retained. Okay, so the retention of records is also important. Whenever it is necessary, that e-records, we can take the printout of the e-record and we can submit it. Okay, in the Evidence Act, I want to clarify one thing. In the Evidence Act, okay, two sections have been introduced. Once after this IT Act 2000, that is 65, A and B has been added according to the Information Technology Act, where the e-records have been authenticated. There are so many Supreme Court judgments regarding that. We can consider the e-records. E-records means any printout of a document sent officially from a person, if it is signed or not signed, if it is sent through his official email ID, through his official digital signatures, or through his official authentic methods, if he has transmitted that record, means that he is eligible to submit as an evidence to the court if it is necessary. Either it can be a CCTV footage, or it may be an email, or it may be a data stored in a computer, okay, or it may be a thumb impression, whatever may be. Okay, that is having a legal approval, and all the courts will take, if it is necessary, if it is relevant in that particular case, that e-records will be considered. That is, they cannot insist that printout is acceptable. That will be considered as a valid evidence, and the court will proceed in that particular manner, that particular matter further. Okay, that is known as the e-records, the retention of e-records. The Evidence Act 65A and B have been amended and added to the Evidence Act so that all the courts should accept that e-records in the format it is originally generated. And here there should be a facility to identify the origin, destination, date and time. Any records, for example, a video captured in a CCTV camera. If you want to produce that as a record for a crime committed in that particular time, then there should be an origin and where, when, where it has been captured, and date and time will be there, that will be recorded and it will be considered. In while retention, while retaining the e-records, these concepts should be taken care. Origin, where it has been taken, what is the destination, and what is the date and time it has to be recorded. Anything, it is like that, when you have sent an email, when you have sent, from which place you have sent, date and time of sending the e-records, that should be there. Next, publication of rules and regulations in e-cassettes. This is also one of the section that we have discussed previously. Publication of rules and regulations in e-gazette. E-gazette means the electronic gazette. Gazette means, in Kannada we will call it as Rajyapatra. Where the state, either central government or state government, will publish his or the its ordinances or the rules that they are going to implement. Whatever the thing which will be published in the gazette. Gazette notification will come. Anybody who want to interfere in that particular matter can question that which is displayed on the e-gazette. That is published in the gazette. Few days earlier, 1 month or 15 days earlier only, a publication will be given in the gazette. Gazette is the one paper, or we can call it, is where the stand of the government, what the government will perform, what the government will do, what actions the government will do, will be published. Will be published. And hard copy will also be there, that you can see in all the libraries and all these things. Central libraries, it will be available. It will come well in advance. It can be once in 15 days or intermediate. It will be generated. Now it is an e-gazette. Electronic gazette, it will be published in the government website. A provision has been given in the IT Act that is considered as a valid. When it is published on the website, that is the date that will be considered as the date of e-gazette. And the person has no right to insist on accepting the document in e-form. He don't have any right that he can't tell that I cannot accept that the gazette which is announced in the website, or e-gazette you can't reject. That is a valid thing that we can proceed with this. Next, power to make rules. Lastly, the central government will prescribe. Central government has all the powers to make the rules and regulations. In the IT Act 2000, IT Amendment Act 2008, certain powers have been transferred from the central government to the state government. Let us see in further classes. But the central government has the provision to make the rules in digital signature, in the manner and format of digital signature, identification of person affixing the digital signature, control process, security and integrity, all these matters, the central government has the powers to make the rules. That is there in the इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी एक्ट। सो विद दिस माय डियर फ्रेंड्स वी हैव गॉन थ्रू सर्टेन सेक्शंस, इंपॉर्टेंट सेक्शंस ऑफ आईटी एक्ट 2000, एंड विद दिस आई विल कंक्लूड टुडेज सेशन। इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन वी विल टेक अप सम मोर इंपॉर्टेंट सेक्शंस विच विल सपोर्ट दिस ई गवर्नेंस, ई ट्रांजैक्शंस, विच विल गिव अ लीगल फॉर्मेट, लीगल फॉर्म टू एन ई गवर्नेंस विच विल बी हेल्पफुल इन अवर डे टू डे लाइफ। ओके, with this, as usual, the reference is Information Technology Bare Act 2000 and your prescribed books. Okay. Thank you. We will meet in the next class.